previously on Anachronology.
80.
You really couldn't tell the difference besides the Adam's apple.
Hey, I'm having phone sex in my car.
Mullet time in the 80s.
Because it is rad.
And it was bad.
The Anachronauts, they travel through time by downloading history to their brains and archive the past in order to save the future. With their trusty brain download computer, the Epic Traverseer, they randomly visit the past year after year. Join them as they embark on their next adventure. Prepare yourself for Anachronology.
Howdy.
Hello.
Welcome
to Anachronology,
where it's about damn time. My name is Clay. This is my co-host, Tom. Welcome to the show. If you're a returning degenerate or anachronaut, thank you for coming back. And if you're new here, my co-host, Tom, and I, well, from the years 1982 to present day, we are tasked with gathering everything that has happened and chronicling it for people here to have a chronicle, a purpose to go back and see what has occurred. And, you know, we've been entrusted to do that. And if you want to help us do that, you can also please just do a little subscribey button right there that costs you nothing. And if you want to throw us a couple shekels, we got a little Patreon where we put out exclusive content. You get an extra bonus segment and, well, a little something extra, a little something extra for you for those Patreon members. Tom, how are you doing?
Good, buddy. Great intro. Welcome, everybody, to the show. If it's your first time watching, you're in for a treat. We are the Anachronauts. We, like Clay said, we travel through history and time, documenting the good, the bad, the ugly, the sad, whatever happens to fall that year. We are, of course, sophisticated on our show. We use AI technology that incorporated with our very own AI producer, who will probably jump on and be mad at us and tell us we're doing something wrong. And we also type into our supercomputer, the Epoch Traverser, which allows us to temporally travel to anywhere in history. So we have some pretty sweet tech here at the show.
Human error is a big part of this program, but you know, you can't blame it all on us. We do have, we are beholden to our computer overlords. We have, like Tom mentioned, the Epic Traverser and AI producer. So where we travel to is determined by both AI producer and the Epic Traverser, neither of which we could not do the show without them. So I guess, Tom, we've been, this is episode, I'm not sure what number we're on now. Is this 9, 10? I mean, something along those lines.
We rounded it off with 8, my friend. I feel like this is the big 8. We have been all over the place. We have been back to the year of my birth, 82, as far back in the timeline as we've been. We've fooled around in the 90s. We've seen a little of the 2000s. Hell, I think we jumped 3 years ago back to 2021 at one point. But that's the cool part, is it's a completely randomized year of travel, and we also get a completely randomized category selection. So it's always weird and wild and different. And I know I've seen some people say, hey, you missed this in this year. Don't worry. No one's to say we can't go back to that year with all new categories and all new stuff to talk about. And if you think we've missed something that we should have talked about, throw it in the comments on any of the social sites. If you're following us on the Insta, following us on the Talk, following us on YouTube, hit us up. Let us know what we're doing right. Hell, let us know what we're doing wrong, because that's half the battle.
And, you know, one thing that Tom and I like nothing more than to engage in the people that are engaged with the people that are fellow Anachronauts. So I guess without further ado, my friend, should we figure out where we need to go?
Let's go, baby. Let's throw it to Epoch. See what
it is time to find today's time coordinates from the Epoch Traverser.
Here we go. In all its glory. High tech glory. Where are we going? Where are we going?
81.
Good one. I was going to say 97. Wow.
20. Oh, wait, yeah. That's right.
It always gets this.
This is
jamming. I like this. Epoch Traverser always laying down the 8-bit hit.
Play along at home. Do you know this 8-bit rendition of this, I would say, relatively successful 80s jam?
How cool are you? Come on. Do you know this?
I am actually, Tom is not a titular member of this band. I am, because I am a man without a hat. That was Men Without Hats, the safety dance.
Well put. Yeah, absolutely. Because you can dance. You can dance if you want to.
All right. So if I obviously the safety dance did not come out in 2010, but if we do get the year that comes out, we are doing a watch party of that video, because
it's a fantastic video.
The supporting actor, or the supporting character of that video, is a little person, and he is having a blast of a time dancing around the safety dance and like a wasted broad. But okay, 2010.
So great tastes. Yeah, I think 2010, I mean, obviously 2010 is not ringing too many bells. I think this happens when we get our year selected, and then obviously we take our temporal travel back to that time. We're freshly downloaded, and now we can talk about it. But yeah, man, there's nothing that's like, hey, 2010, remember what the hell was I doing in 2010? I don't know.
Okay. Can't even remember. I know that I went to a cousin's wedding because I broke my leg, and I had to travel in a cast. So then I had to get, I got wheeled through the airport in a wheelchair, got to board first. Pretty good if you don't have a private jet. Just break your leg, you get wheeled to the front. Scary. You don't have to go with splurge and have, you know, private pilots, you know, all that. Just break your leg.
Easy to break one's leg.
Yeah, I mean, that's like the biggest thing that stands out.
A pretty big one to happen. Yeah, any kind of major break or sprain, or if you're in a cast, that's a pretty big one. And reap the advantages of it, obviously. Yeah, 2010. Yeah, I'm excited to find out, obviously, what we need to talk about in 2010. So let's jump to our first sponsor break here on the show. We'll be right back after that. Of course, we're going to have to jump to 2010. If you haven't done this before, I would just advise maybe, stay seated. Don't stand up too fast after this. Yeah. And the nosebleeds they'll end eventually. So don't freak out. It's nothing bad. It's like a bug bite.
We'll be right here with you.
All right. Hang tight, people. See you soon.
We're back.
Granted. We'll be right back after a word from our sponsors.
This portion of Anachronology is brought to you by Jeremiah Slopjaw Family Style Trough Restaurant. Welcome to Jeremiah Slopjaw's Family Style Trough Restaurant. Are you tired of stuffy dining experiences and pretentious etiquette? Then come on down to Jeremiah Slopjaw's, where we're serving up hearty meals with a side of good old-fashioned fun. Picture this: long troughs filled to the brim with mouth-watering comfort food classics. From savory fried chicken and mashed potatoes to succulent ribs and corn on the cob, our troughs are overflowing with flavor that'll make your taste buds dance. And here's the best part: no utensils, no napkins, and certainly no manners required. That's right, at Jeremiah Slopjaw's, we encourage you to dive right in with your hands and embrace the joy of messy family-style dining. For one fixed price, you can feast like never before, indulging in as much food as your heart desires. And if you've got the sweet tooth, don't miss out on our dessert trough buffet for just $9.99 extra. From gooey brownie to fluffy pies, it's a sugary paradise you won't want to miss. So gather your friends, gather your family, and come on down to Jeremiah Slopjaw's Family Style Trough Restaurant, where every meal is a celebration of good food, good company, and good times. We'll see you at the trough.
Mmm.
You are watching Anachronology.
Hello, welcome back. I hope you enjoyed that message from Jeremiah Slopjaw's Family Trough Restaurant. Take your family, take your friends, get on down there. You know, like they said, no napkins, no manners required. Go and have yourself a face full of pig slop. You know you want to.
Yeah, I want to, definitely. I can't wait for one to open up near me. Welcome back. You made it. You got to the other side on your temporal journey to 2010, and you're here with us now in 2010. Obviously, I think it's a little more clear what 2010 was about now that we've kind of gotten our download from Epoch Traverser. So yeah, I mean, Clay, let's break down 2010. What in the hell was 2010?
Should we do a little bit of a year in review? Well, So what I see here, not a lot of happy news. We're starting off with the Haitian earthquake in January of 2010. Haiti was struck by a devastating earthquake, resulting in widespread destruction and loss of life. So
big one.
Yeah, that's not a good way to kick off the new year.
What a shotgun start to a possible hellish 2010.
That picture right there, dude. I mean, I know Haiti isn't like the first world of first world countries, but that is just
unreal,
dude. It looks like a fake, like
it
diorama.
Does.
It looks like a diorama.
Yeah, it's crazy, and it's just, you know, it's fucked up because a place like that already is so, you know, obviously third world and just kind of behind the times, and then something like that happens and it sets it even further back. If you can imagine that, it's just like, it's awful. It's just so debilitating.
All right. Well, we can get off that bad news. Let's go to at least, oh, some more bad news. Oh, hey, look at this. This was the Deepwater Horizon oil spill. The Deepwater Horizon oil rig exploded in the Gulf of Mexico, causing one of the worst environmental disasters in history.
Oh yeah, definitely. And I also think it spawned one of the worst Mark Wahlberg movies. I think he did the he did the Deepwater Horizon movie too. Glory of that to come out a few years after.
You know, I think the AI producer was probably wanting to keep the bad news at a minimum. That's why they didn't bring up that movie. But what they did bring up was this. Remember, this is what they gave South Park, the we're sorry, the we're sorry.
That's right.
Which was like, this was the CEO of British Petroleum, BP, the owners of Deepwater Horizon. And in that episode of South Park, it was just this guy apologizing for all of the awful, awful things that came from the exploding oil rig. And you know what? If you destroy hundreds of thousands of acres of water and untold amounts of sea life, hey, why not? You just got to say you're sorry and you're fine.
That's it. You got to pay for a nice ad on TV and repeatedly say you're sorry. And of course, we'll forget about it. Some other terrible thing will happen and it'll just, you know, be third page news.
So this actually is a little bit of a silver lining for some good news. The Chilean mining disaster, 33 miners were trapped underground for 69 days in a Chilean mine before being rescued successfully and capturing, obviously, global attention. I do remember this being on the news pretty much every night, like the updates.
Oh, yeah.
They had a shaft was drilled down so they could breathe oxygen. I think they lowered down, if memory serves me, what the Chilean miners asked for, like aside from food, was pornography. Like they asked, dude, I swear to God, they asked for
what an ask.
Dude, obviously I think they even tried to like send down a telephone line or something, like how they were communicating. And like the first communique was like, we need water, we need food and some porn. So I don't know what those guys were doing down there other than just trying to keep their wits about them. By I guess, you know, miners don't swing that way. So they needed to swing with themselves.
I guess like what was the delivery there? They're just like, yo, let's go find some like old, like dusty 1980s Playboys and roll them up and shove them down in a little like banker's tube for them.
Dude, in Chile, they probably had some like vintage, like hustler smut. They definitely had some like,
oh yeah,
vintage. The fact that those Chilean guys were asking for pornography, they know that the Chileans have a very nice, fine selection. Only the finest for the miners trapped 69 days below ground. But hey, it was also very fitting, asking for pornography and being trapped for 69 days. I mean, that's very fitting of a number.
It is very fitting.
What's next here in the year in review? Oh, yes. More good news. The Arab Spring begins. The Arab Spring movement began in Tunisia, sparking pro-democracy protests across several Arab countries, including Libya, Egypt, Yemen, Syria, and Bahrain. This was a protest in the Muslim countries of their religious theocratic leadership, which they were trying to bring about some sort of democracy. And this Arab Spring started in 2010 and lasted, kind of tapered off around 2012. And I'm going to let you guys listening on a little secret. Their bid for pro-democracy didn't really work. It was strong, but everything just kind of got clamped down. You can, you know, protest in the streets all you want. When the people who are the powers that be just start rolling in tanks down the street, you kind of can't fight that fire potter with some protest signs. You got to have a little more of a coup on your hands.
Yeah. Sorry, guys.
So apologies to all of those who lost their lives, who, you know, were thrown in jail. But you guys were kind of fighting uphill there. What's next in 2010? Oh, yes. And more great news. The 2010 economic recession. Countries continued to grapple with the effects of the global economic disaster that was 2008, with unemployment rates remaining high in several regions. I think that's an understatement at the very least. Even
in
2010, I mean, for 13 years removed, it really hasn't gotten any better. The fact that in the real estate crisis that triggered all of this, the fact that it lasted for two, or it should snowballed into 2 years to having effect in 2010. I mean, I don't know how many corners you got to cut, but no bueno in 2010 financial situation. Give me some good news. Give me some good news. All right, look at this. The World Cup came.
Soccer is good news.
You know, much like the Olympics, every 4 years, countries you know, put aside their differences to wage, you know, in friendly competition on the field that is the soccer pitch or the football pitch. The only thing I really remember about this, I couldn't even tell you who the winner was of this. My apologies on that. But the one thing I do remember was the Vuvuzelas. Remember those trumpet things that were playing in the stands? Like just that harmonic drone.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
Like I'm surprised that they have that instrument hasn't made its way into more sporting events. The only reason why I think it hasn't is because it was so goddamn annoying in South Africa. There they are, the little Vuvuzelas.
I can hear it now.
Dude, I think that the world was put on blast, no pun intended, of how annoying those things are. And so if you were to walk into any place with those, like, I think security knows just to take that right away from you. We're not having that nonsense here on the old sporting events.
Too much noise.
What do we got here? What's next in 2010? Ah, yes. Julian Assange, WikiLeaks.
Yep.
WikiLeaks, a platform for leaking classified information, released a trove of diplomatic cables, causing diplomatic tensions and sparking debates on transparency and secrecy. Now,
homeboy got in trouble.
Yeah, he is. He is still, I believe, he is awaiting trial still. So he was arrested. You know, basically over a decade ago, and as far as having a fair and speedy trial, he did not get. But what he did get was a little bit of a biopic starring Benedict Cumberbatch.
Look at that freaking hairpiece,
dude!
It's not even close, and it's just like I feel like they made Julian Assange look like way more creepy albino-y than he is in real life.
I mean, I guess if you squint. I mean, he still looks like Benedict Cumberbatch. with an albino haircut, not so much like Julian Assange.
He looks like he's going to get on a dragon and fly away. He looks like a fucking Targaryen or something. It's very strange choice of all of it, really.
He looks like a high school theater teacher that just got caught doing something he shouldn't got caught doing. That's what he looks
That's more on point. That's
what he looks like. And then what do we have? Anything to round it off with? Oh, us! The launch of the original iPad. Look, January 27th, 2010 was announced, released 2 months later, April 3rd, 2010. What do we got here for the specs? 9.7 inch, dude, 1024 times 768 pixel resolution. Woo! Ooh, don't go crazy on me now, OG iPad.
Hey now.
A 1 gigahertz A4 processor, which I don't think Apple took that out until 10 years later. They're not the biggest fan of upgrading their hardware. And then 10-hour battery. 10-hour battery. There's no way.
That's a kind claim. I don't know if that was really true.
My iPhone now, which is... use my Apple Care to, you know, hey, I want a new iPhone because this one's broken. So, you know, you get a new iPhone. So my iPhone battery doesn't last, you know, 10 hours. And I know that's not, it's a smaller battery than an iPad, but I mean, all the brightness, the pulling from the Wi-Fi, like what that thing is using to make it work. There's no way in hell that had a 10-hour battery, especially for $499. That probably sounds about like, is that about what they cost now? Like an iPad mini now, like that probably costs. Is that right?
Oh yeah, probably in that range, like a real small or older version. I mean, Christ, it's amazing to see that the phones are like double that nowadays. Like just the goddamn phones. Like you go out and buy the newest iPhone that comes out. It's steep, man. It's like $700-800 plus, you know, yeah, depending on whatever you're adding to it. I mean, this thing too, when it came out, it just looked like a giant iPhone, really. You know, it had that thick kind of build to it. They didn't really sleek it out, all the old ports on it.
I mean, it didn't, I remember the complaint was didn't have a headphone jack. That was a big one, right? Doesn't have a headphone jack.
Yeah.
The only apps that could run, the app store, I think, and it's the apps that were available on the app store, they still needed to be, when you specify for the iPad itself, right? It's like, just because there's the app store that exists and you can have it on your phone, that you still needed to like spec it out to make sure it would work on the iPad. For $499 in 2010, not too bad of a investment, I guess, if you want to play Candy Crush, even if Candy Crush existed at that point in time. Well,
interesting 2010, kind of coming with the tragedy, coming with the innovation, coming with Benedict Cumberbatch looking a dragon rider. Very interesting choice of a lot of what happened that year, refreshing my memory. But let's get into the nuts and bolts of this episode, because obviously we're here in 2010, but we need to talk about a very specific set of archival. So let's roll back over to our friend Epoch Traverser. Let's
see what he has for us.
Epoch, what are we talking about this episode?
Ronauts, welcome to today's year. Please proceed in discussing the following categories provided by your galactic overlords. Thank you and have a wonderful day.
Bring it on.
Category one. Smurfs.
The category is sports.
Sports. Fun.
The category is science.
Let's get heady. Three. Hey. Sounds fun.
Category is cartoons.
It's like one out of left field.
Yeah. It's like very three non-associated things.
Oh, right. Yeah, I mean, really went from like, you know, A to B to fucking Z right there in that category selection there. Very, very interesting. Sports, science, and cartoons. Wow. Wowzer is what I'm thinking. Okay. I mean, I guess we dive right into the first one. You want to dive into sports first? Want to go in the order of what Pac laid out?
You know, let's go down here to, let me just see what we've got here for a producer scrolling. Okay. So, Mr. Air producer, what do we have for sports? So
sports. For sports.
All right. For sports, the first thing that comes up is the Saints versus Colts Super Bowl in 2010.
Yep.
And this was a contest, a big, it was Peyton Manning versus Drew Brees. And the biggest, I guess, standout of this game was Indianapolis looked unstoppable in the first quarter when Manning led his team down the field multiple times, blah, 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 blah. The Saints came out strong in the second quarter as they began to get on their feet underneath them. Unfortunately, their aggressive goal line play calling by the Saints at the end of the second quarter resulted in Indianapolis heading to the locker room at halftime with a 10-6 lead. Then the unthinkable happened. So this is why it's important. It's unthinkable. Sean Payton, the head coach of the New Orleans Saints, called for an onside kick to start the second half, and New Orleans recovered. This is where many believe the momentum changed in the Saints' favor and would never return to the Colts. New Orleans would end up winning Super Bowl 44 with a score of 31-17, even with Manning at the helm of the Colts.
Wow.
So I think what there actually is video evidence of this. Let's pull this up. Oh, look, it's our YouTube channel. Hey, you should guys go to YouTube, Anachronology, and just do a little quick subscribe here.
Shout out.
Yeah, let me
check
just
it
go.
Out. A lot of fun stuff. Play
go to the sports videos. If we go in here. And
history. Sean Payton ambushing the Colts to start the second half of Super Bowl.
Here we go.
the onside kick, boys. So the
Saints will kick it away. All right. High drama. Start of the second half. And then a little
doinker kick there.
Oh my
That's it. That's that momentum of
Oh my, wait, onside kick? You got to be kidding me. John Godzilla's can't believe it. So I was not at a Super Bowl party when this happened, but I was, let me get this out of here. I was not at a Super Bowl party with it, but I was watching this live. And I remember because the Colts were winning, 10-6, but I remember when that happened, I didn't lose my mind as much as everyone, I guess, in the sports world. But I remember thinking, oh, shit, onside kick, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, and different.
Yeah, not something I guess you usually pull out of the bag of tricks, especially during the Super Bowl. And there is video. I remember seeing this like shortly after because it was such a big deal. And there's cameras everywhere at the Super Bowl. There was Sean Payton, the head coach of the Saints. He was going up to the referee, like the head ref, and he was saying, we're going to kick an onsides kick. And the ref was like, yeah, it's okay. You can do that. Because everyone, like, there was talk that you couldn't do that. it was illegal. Like, wow. it was a completely valid play. And so just to make sure, he's like, hey, we're going to do this. And the ref was all like, yeah, it's cool. You could do that. And people were like, he can't do that. It's like, well, yeah, you can. He just did. So,
and he did it. Yeah. And he shifted the dynamic there. I mean, and that's just really how it is in a lot of these big sporting events. Events, especially in football, definitely in baseball too, it can flip the script like that. A play can just completely change the outcome of everything, and that's a cool thing to see.
And for a game that was supposed to be decided by the arms of arguably one of the greatest quarterbacks, Peyton Manning, and also a fellow Hall of Famer when he goes in there, Drew Brees, the game was could argue decided by a kicker's foot and not the arm of a quarterback. Wow. And the next in sports, what we have here, this was the 2010 Vancouver Winter Olympics. Epic. And this unfortunately is continuing the trend that the year in review laid out for us, because this is no good news. So Georgian luger Nodar, I'm very sorry, I'm going to butcher your last name, dude. Kumaral Shivali. Died before the opening ceremony. He's Georgian, not the country, not the state. Died before the opening ceremony of the 2010 Vancouver Olympics after losing control of his sled on a training run and hitting a steel pole that was unpadded. The International Luge Federation conducted an investigation where they determined that human error was the cause of the deadly training run crash. While there was no indication that the accident was caused by deficiencies in the track itself, it was later redesigned with higher walls and padded beams, now meant to limit speeds to just about 87 miles per hour.
Just about that? Jesus Christ. And unfortunately, it took human error to decide to change that up. I guess it's good it didn't happen on a live broadcast as well. That would have made for quite an interesting, memorable Olympics.
Well, Tom, we do have video footage. There's cameras, much like the Super Bowl, there's cameras everywhere at the Olympics. Sure. So, unfortunately, we do have video proof of.
Yeah, let's see it.
What happened?
Practice run. The loser flew over the wall and crashed into a pole. Jeff Glor is in Vancouver too.
Yeah, that looks pretty awful.
And then, they just show it again.
His body is just like a rag doll.
21-year-old Nodar Kumaratashvili of the former Soviet Republic of Georgia went over a track wall at.
Damn.
Oh, yeah. And then they got to do the freeze frame of his body just in free fall. I mean, I would just imagine even with a helmet on, it's just all if your spine hits something the wrong way.
Neck,
spine.
I don't have the athletic prowess to even sniff the Olympics. So anyone who makes it to the Olympics has a tip of my cap. However, the luge, the other name for the luge is the skeleton sled, because it's just a pair of freaking rails, and you just lay down on it and put your little feet pointing. If there's any event where you're kind of like taking fate into your own hands, it's running on two little pieces of metal at 90 miles per hour down like a vertical drop of a mile.
I mean, man.
Jeez Louise. So R.I.P. to Georgian loser Nodar Kumarla Shivali.
One's for you, so, dog.
Yeah, man, I am sorry that you lost your life. And also here, this is actually an interesting one. So Curt Schilling, your Boston Red Sox, Tom, a Hall of Fame pitcher, savior of the 2003 World Series team. So apparently, I know this is a little weird because this is not necessarily sports per se, but he is a icon of baseball. He broke the curse, the Yankee curse, as part of that 2003 Yankee team. So apparently, Schilling is a very big gamer. Here he is doing this, doing some more gaming, and he wanted to take, I guess, competitiveness of sports. And it says here, Schilling wanted to develop a large scale title in the MMORPG genre, winning a market competitor for the World of Warcraft. Taking on World of Warcraft. Yeah, he says he later noted that it might have been easier to design in another genre. Yeah, you think so?
Yeah,
the biggest. So he brought in two well-known creators, one of which a comic book artist Tom McFarlane to handle the artistic direction. So the world and lore, Schilling was comparing this to a modern day Lord of the Rings project. I'm sorry, modern day Lord of the Rings. This was known as Project Copernicus, and this was initially scheduled for a 2011 release, and the name of his studios was 38 Studios, was projecting an annual profit of over $100 million from the revenue. Wow. 38 Studios' ambition was noted in 2009 in light of competition in the MMO market, and there was also noted that the 38 Studios was spending quite a lot of money without releasing anything. And it also drew attention from wider video game industry and media when veteran Jason Booth noting that ambition was a requirement of success in the industry, but Schilling tried to minimize his direct involvement with the production, even though the studio folded. And here he is leaving court because he kind of got embroiled in a little bit of up to no good nicks here. $200 million, I guess, that went into trying to produce the competitor to World of Warcraft. You had a better chance of going against the New York Yankees, buddy. I guess don't mess with the nerds in the video game genre, Kurt.
Yeah, dude. And this tracks. I mean, Schilling to date is always kind of a hot mess, big mouth. I imagine a lot of that money went to some pretty badass parties, probably some capucha necklaces or whatever he's got on there. And, some random nights, I'm sure. If you're Curt Schilling, you're having a good time. Doesn't matter if you're playing baseball or you're making video games, you're having a good time.
I do like how they're just mobbing him outside of the court. Like, get away from me. With all that money.
I know. Kurt, what happened to the $200 million? We don't even have a game.
What happened to Lord of the Rings Part 5? Oh yeah. Don't look at my bank account. And
that's pretty much it.
This was, I actually wanted to, there was tennis, there was golf that I saw here, you know, kind of all the standard fare for 2010. But this actually caught my eye because it was the basically halfway or a good chunk of the way to a record being broken in 2010. This gentleman here, Chris Anderson, I will give you one guess as to what sport this gentleman plays.
He looks like a tough bloke.
So
hard rugby, perhaps
close, very close. Right country, wrong sport. Chris Anderson is a ground worker and British Army veteran, best known for winning the annual cheese rolling at Cooper's Hill in Gloucestershire. And he won it a record as of the recording of this podcast. He has won it a record 23 times.
Damn.
However, in 2010, this was...
Wow.
Was a his fifth year in a row, and I believe we should have
that is impressive. That's like being the Yankees of cheese rolling.
And if anyone hasn't seen cheese rolling, we got a little bit of a play.
You're welcome. This is amazing. It's such insanity. Oh my gosh. Like, what are the, like, broken bones and things that happen during these things?
Oh, a lot.
Get that cheese.
The slow motion. You got anything else? Oh, yeah. They also do different heats, but man.
Freaking incredible. And, you know, I wonder, you know, if you're a bloke that is winning these things, you must have a go-to strategy. Like, what is your strategy? I'd love to know. Get inside of this guy's mind. I mean, some of these guys are just diving down the hill. They're like, but the role seems like all different kinds of chaos. Like that guy's just like front rolling.
There's got to be like dislocated shoulders, busted noses, I mean, blown ACLs. And there's like different heats too. There's not just like one. It's not just like one race, because Lord, I think they did it like incredible. Where they said everybody down at once, and that caused like too many injuries, so they had to do heats. So in 2010, Chris Anderson, you were on your way to breaking the record of all time wins at the Gloucester cheese rolling competition. So good on you, Chris. And like I said, there was like the standard fare of golf and tennis, but I mean, what can you beat if you can't beat cheese rolling? Not a lot. I mean, cheese rolling is taking the cake there, no pun intended.
Dude, cheese rolling, I think, is just kind of it's a sleeper, you know? It's one of those things when you see it and you see the pure just anguish people put themselves through to catch this cheese. And I mean, I assume there's some kind of monetary win. You win something besides a trophy and the title of being the main cheese grabber or whatever.
I'll give you one guess what you win.
You win the cheese. You win the cheese. Awesome. You win
cheese and bragging rights, my friend. Cheese and bragging rights.
You know, I got this fucking cheese right here.
Well, speaking of cheese, I think it's time for a segment where people can say cheese, my friend. We're bringing back this segment. I know it played well with our viewers. It played well with us. So we're bringing back Dollar Store Celebrity.
Oh, I love Dollar Store Celebrity.
2010.
It's a good one. This is fun. Played this a few episodes ago and got good response from it. I'm excited to see in the world of doppelganging.
So as much as we unfortunately are beholden to our, our time overlords here, bringing you things such as sports and science and cartoons and what happened in what year, we also got to have a little bit of fun, a little more fun on the show. And
entertainment.
When we have little segments here. One of those segments is Dollar Store Celebrities. And as Tom said, we had this a couple episodes ago. So here is some celebrities that were famous in 2010. Okay. And it should be a little easy and get a little harder. So I think this first one is going to be pretty easy. I mean, it's pretty easy though.
It's pretty on the nose. I mean,
pretty on the nose.
The prop in the picture as well is helping, I think. I mean, I think he has, I would probably say even the type of glasses would be the type of glasses this person would wear. The hair, maybe a little too much.
I want to say that this man was well known for wearing, like, he had the collar on his turtlenecks was a little more up. I don't know how he kind of biffed the shirt. Like, the shirt does not look like as easy as it is to find one of those kind of turtlenecks. This guy kind of biffed that.
Yeah. But,
if you are playing along at home and you guessed Steve Jobs, you are correct for this Dollar Store Celebrity. Now this one also, he should be a little easy. This is kind of a no-brainer. Kind of a no-brainer.
Pretty decent, actually. Not bad. I mean, obviously, I think the eyes are killing it. The face in general. Yeah, it's pretty good.
I think that the one thing where it can stands out, where the hairdo, in the makeup as well, that is very on brand for this celebrity.
Yeah.
I can see like the stray strands of hair, like the celebrity hairstyle, the hairstyles that the celebrity would have had done their due, they would not be leaving out those stray strands of hair.
They would not.
So that's kind of like a dollar store giveaway. The very, very thin necklace, she would definitely, this real celebrity would be wearing nice, much more nicer jewelry. And also the photo that is taken in a nondescript, like non-luxury hotel hallway, also not on brand for if you're playing at home and you said Rihanna, you are correct.
Riri.
Now it gets a little more difficult, I think.
That's good.
Who is good. This Dollar Store Celebrity be in 2010?
Yep.
If you're playing along at home, this man has an accent. I'll give you that. He has an accent. He is probably most well known for something that was adapted from what he created and adapted here for the American audience.
Yeah, probably this character that he's pretending to portray here would be his most famous character.
And he's also well known for not being allowed to host award shows anymore for calling out celebrities. And if you said Ricky Gervais, you would be right.
Not bad. He's got the like pursed lip thing that what was his name? David something in the office.
Was it David Brent?
David Brent. Yeah, Brent. That's very much a David Brent pose right there, all in all.
It also just kind of looks like a like stock footage, like a Getty Images, like Upset Boss, which I guess kind of like David Brent. Although I wouldn't say he was necessarily upset all the time, but aloof, you know, not the brightest. But this just kind of looks like a Getty Image kind of. Can you meet me in here with HR kind of look? Who is next? Also, kind of easy.
Okay.
But it also just. Pardon me. This also could just be like, I am 23 in grad school and I'm going out with my freshman friends.
A good Halloween costume or
good
something.
Halloween, yes.
And this person just happened to have some of the little characteristics of this famous person. That possibly is a wig. It's probably not the real hair, but that everything else is, it's selling it, I guess.
Yeah, and it's just, I think that I'm not, even in, like, again, this is 2010 celeb, so even in 2010, I think this person who is a little too old looking, she pulls it off, but definitely still looks a little long in the tooth, but if you said Taylor Swift, then you are correct.
Oh, man.
So I believe there is a similarity with this dollar store celebrity and one from our previous round or the previous episodes. And that is I believe that this person who is portraying the celebrity is not a male. I believe this is a female.
That's somebody's mom again, just like being cool. And they went to the Halloween store and found this makeup kit. I mean, it's funny, but I will say like, this person's like facial build and like even everything from the jawline to the shape of their body in it being like somebody's mom, like a smaller built woman, actually works fairly well for this caricature of this doppelganger here.
And I don't remember. It's an interesting choice having like the New Mexico turquoise earring in. That's an interesting choice.
The huge gauge in there.
Yeah, I don't think Justin Bieber ever had that as part of his getup, but
this is
not
way harder. Just Justin Bieber. This is like a Justin Bieber who's seen some shit. He's done some time. He might even be an informant. Justin Bieber.
Oh, I like that. Yeah,
he's definitely
21 Jump Street Bieber.
Yeah, he's totally 21 Jump Street, and he's undercover trying to bust up some kind of shit in high school. Justin Bieber, but it's trying real hard to be Justin Bieber.
And now that I'm looking at it, I don't really know if Bieber rocked the denim bleach acid washed like vest with some flair. There's a little bit of flair on there.
A lot of flair.
There's a little bit of flair on there, but I agree with you, my friend. The facial, you know, makeup, not too scabby.
Mom, Justin Bieber doesn't wear that much flair.
Next is this one is I could see people not getting this one.
There's a gut inside of me that just immediately screamed out who it was that, and when it did, it was like, this is the worst case scenario. If this is who this person is, I do think that it is who they're trying to be.
Yes,
but you're right. It could go a lot of different ways. I would say the big giveaway is the hair.
Yes. I think
that
like
the person leaned heavily into the fact that their hair looked kind of like that, or they fucking did something to it.
I believe he's also probably a little lucky that for this person's profession, they wear a suit. So like, that's kind of an easy thing to like fill out as part of your, you know, making one look like someone, like their clothing, like as opposed to wearing like a denim acid wash vest with buttons all over it. This guy had to do was grab a suit. And he quaffed up that hair. And his dude is, I think, as old as in 2010, however old this guy is in 2010, he is probably still 10 years older than the person who he is doppelganging or celebrity dollar store looking like, which if you said Conan O'Brien, you are right.
This is just like, it's definitely, that's just the hair. And I don't know, maybe the bug-eyed, wide-eyed look or something, but it's like, it's bad Conan O'Brien.
I think that like look, I think he's probably like the hair 100%. That's all that guy has is the hair for this. But I think he probably is thinking Conan makes funny faces on TV, so I'll just pull the face and I'll let my hair get me through it. Who is next on Dollar Store Celebrities? This is a hard one. This is hard. This, like, if you're playing at home, this is like, if this is a MySpace photo, this is not.
I've met this kid before. I feel like, you know, like this is somebody you've met in your life. I think I kind of know who this person's trying to be. And again, I would say it heavily leans on hairdo. They're just sheer complexion, which I think matches the actor.
And I think they're also trying to, like, whatever this is cropped, like whatever they took the backdrop of this photo, there is like a little spookiness in there. There's like a face above him, which
I see it.
And I don't know if that's supposed to be like a tombstone over a shoulder, if he's supposed to be like in a cemetery or something. But yes, if you said Twilight's Robert Pattinson, you would be correct for this dollar store celebrity. And I think the last one is going to be, this is a twofer. So these are both dollar store celebrities.
Double duty. I think I got the one on the left. One on the right could go many different ways. I feel like this woman on the right, this older woman, everything from the haircut to the what she's wearing. I mean, I feel like she could check a couple of boxes for like 80s, 90s sitcom female character. I mean, Christ.
You were definitely correct with sitcom and old lady. And she, one could say she was a girl. She was one of four girls on the show she was on, although she wasn't that young. It was titular. But yes, I think kind of like the one on the left, she is, as they say, in the South, bless her heart. Bless her heart. She is trying to be Lady Gaga so bad.
And all she did was just put a shit ton of eyeliner on and like this hot red, you know, lipstick with just like a bleach blonde haircut. Really, I mean, that's all that she's done. I don't think she really.
And she got dressed by the same person who dressed a doppelganger Bieber. Like, apparently, denim was really big for these 2010 celebrities. And the older woman on the right, which I wouldn't have gotten this either unless I had the answer key. Betty White. That is Betty White. And I'm not seeing it, but I guess this was like a meeting of the minds, like the old guard or changing of the guard, like Betty White passing off her status as the hottest female impersonator to Lady Gaga. So thank you for playing Dollar Store Celebrities at home.
That was a good one. There was some sheer trickery in that one. That was good. I gotta say, I like when we do these. I think some of them are like instant giveaways, and then others are very, very thought provoking. You got to think long and hard about it.
Oh, and then
we get you working here.
Is there? Hold on a second. Is there one more? Oh, there is one more. It's a trick question. This is a trick question. I forgot about the trick question.
Wow.
This is a trick question.
Whoa.
Now I'm. I'm gonna give you a big hint here. Okay, this is a big hint. So, this actually is a celebrity, and this celebrity was this is part of a commercial he did to for the Indian market. So he was being like an Indian Bollywood producer.
Yeah, it's terribly like racist as hell too. It's
that is why the commercial got pulled from the air due to racist backlash, because this actor himself does not have Indian blood or heritage. Is from the American Midwest.
I'm getting It's not Mark Ruffalo, is it?
Younger than Ruffalo.
Okay.
Was made famous on a TV sitcom.
Is it Ashton Kutcher?
Ashton Kutcher.
Wow. It looks nothing. Yeah, it really looks creepy. It's very Indian Austin Powers too. Vibe. It's weird.
Apparently, there was a 2010 commercial for something called Pop Chips, which I guess this was supposed to be a snack for the Eastern Hemisphere of the world. And for whatever reason, Ashton Kutcher signed off on getting in brownface and said, I will be your Bollywood producer for Pop Chip. So
look no further, guys. Just do me up as racist as possible. Let's really go for this.
My apologies for sneaking in that last one, but he technically really wasn't. He was a real celebrity. So that was a little trickery. I apologize.
Fantastic. Well, amazing extra segment there that we'd like to toss in. Dollar store celebrities, followed by our first category, which I think went down pretty well here in 2010. Good old sports. Let's take a quick break. We'll come back with category two and keep on moving down in 2010.
Be right back.
Later.
We'll be right back after these messages. Go get yourself some gabagool.
All right, so this break here on Anachronology is brought to you by one of our proud sponsors, Illuminati Escorts. Welcome to Illuminati Escort Service. Are you tired of mundane conversations and small talk? Do you crave stimulating discussions about the mysteries of the universe? Then look no further. Illuminati Escort Service is here to satisfy your intellectual curiosity. Our companions are not your average escorts. They are passionate truth seekers who are eager to delve into the depths of conspiracy theories, uncovering hidden truths and unraveling enigmas that will leave you questioning everything you thought you knew. From ancient civilizations and UFO sightings to government cover-ups and secret societies, our companions are well-versed in a wide range of conspiracy topics, guaranteed to ignite your imagination and spark a lively debate. Whether you prefer late-night conversations over coffee or clandestine rendezvous in a dimly lit alleyway, our companions are ready to accompany you on a journey into the unknown. So if you're ready to explore the shadowy realms of the Illuminati, book your appointment with us today. But remember, our companions only want one thing. No touching, only talking about the wildest of conspiracy theories. Are you brave enough to uncover the truth? Join Illuminati Escorts.
You are watching Anachronology.
Welcome back. I hope you
enjoyed that
message from one of our sponsors. I believe that was Illuminati Escort Service.
Good one.
If you're looking for some companionship, but no touching involved, only discussing how JFK got his head blown off by the government. Well, maybe you should call up someone from Illuminati Escort Service. Tom, I believe our next category here is science.
Oh, baby. Love me some science. Love learning something. Okay. Let's learn something.
So I don't mean to put us down, Tom, but we are not the smartest knives in the shed, so to speak. So I don't know how well we'd be able to talk intelligently about the leaps and bounds of scientific discoveries in 2010. However, let's start with something that's a little older than 2010. This is a tooth that was discovered in Siberia. Wow. And this was a tooth of a Denisovian. Scientists announced the discovery of a new hominin species called Denisovians based on genetic analysis of a finger bone found in a cave in Siberia and a tooth, a molar. Denisovians were closely related to Neanderthals and contributed to the genetic makeup of modern humans.
Interesting.
So using this tooth that they found in a cave, they were able to extract some sort of DNA material from it and build a sequenced genome and build what they might look like. And they said closely related to Neanderthals. So the looky-loo that we got is... Well, it's another piece of the tooth. There you can see where they bored into it.
Big tooth.
I can't remember the exact measurements, but it's like twice the size of a normal or of an adult human here. You can see the bore hole there where they drilled the root. And then what they got was, So
a fun little guy.
I mean, I think I've seen some people like that, like when I've gone to Walmart, you know what I mean? That's not too far off. Like that's.
Yeah. I mean, you know, just, I feel like it's got kind of like a Dave Mustaine, like 80s metal hair thing going on too. It's pretty dope.
I mean, I wonder if they know that they had red fur or red hair, or if they're just guessing. Yeah. I wonder if that like marker was in the genome because
and it was red.
Yeah. Cause they are already, I mean, you kind of don't have like the best, I guess, you know, genetic foot forward if you got giant fucking chompers in red hair and black beady little eyes. Like you're
and
not
light kind of skin as well, like a fair almost complexion. I mean, you're getting sunburned. I mean, you talk about was this like the first ginger caveman right here?
That's what I'm thinking. I mean, this is as far as we have evidence of, this is at least one member of our family tree since, again, it says closely related to the Neanderthals and who knows what interbreeding went down. But I mean, this looks pretty close to like, you know,
a
human being. So they've got to be somewhere on our tree.
Pretty much. It's O'Doyle, one day your whole genome's going down scenario.
And to stay in the world of anthropology, there was actually someone older than the Denisovians. This piece of skull. So this is the Ardi is the nickname. And that was the discovery of the Ardipithecus ramidus, nicknamed Ardi in Ethiopia, provided important insights into human evolution.
Ardi.
It is a, I'll give you, okay, this, the Denisovians was hundreds of thousands of years old. Take a guess of how old the Ardi bone is here. How old do you think that Ardi bone is?
Hundreds of thousands.
That was the other one. That was a tooth. This is even older. So
100,000 years old.
4.4 million. Four million year old hominid. Older than there was also another famous fossil discovered in Africa before this called Lucy. But this Ardi, she offered, it says here, clues about bipedalism and early human behavior. Hmm. I don't know how much you can get early human behavior from half of her head, but they were also similarly using the reconstruction of the bone, the facial structure of the bones and the teeth. We have a little looky-loo of what Ardi looked like, and Ardi, kind of cute.
Yeah.
Ardi's kind of cute.
Ardi is like a fun, you know, whatever, like a DreamWorks animation character. He's in,
a little full-body Ardi. Little full-body Ardi there. Oh, they gave her some nice little flat titties. They gave her a little darkened bush. She's got mad big palm.
Wild feet. Hands. Yeah, palmed like big like hand feet. That's pretty crazy.
Yeah, a little Ardi. I mean,
hey, Ardi.
Go to her little face here. Like, I kind of want like a stuffed animal of Ardi. Like,
Ardi's cool.
Yeah, Ardi's got like, there should be, like you said, like a little Pixar, a little Disney animation of Ardi.
Yeah, I mean, Ardi's cool until it wants to eat you and rip you apart. But, you know, I mean, it's fun. Like,
yeah, Ardi with
Ardi's got some ups too. Ardi will fucking grab you and rip your limbs off.
Ardi can rip off your arms and legs with her own arms and legs, her little super opposable toe thumb down there.
Don't sleep on Ardi. Yeah. Ardi was dangerous.
What else we got here? Ah, yes, water on Mars.
Half a dozen missions
to Mars over the past decade have provided clear evidence that the red planet once harbored enough water, either on it or just inside of it, to alter rock formations and possibly sustain life. The Martian water was probably present around the time that life was beginning to appear on Earth, but there is still enough moisture on Mars today to encourage scientists seeking living, breathing microbes. Cool. And this is a famous photo of water ice in a glacier of Mars. And, you know, this is what hopefully this, obviously we have not put human beings on Mars, but this maybe could lead to us being able to thrive there, or at least sustain some life there, because there is water. Yeah. And if you don't have it, then what happens? You turn into Total Recall. That is
the fair. Yeah,
that
movie, you know, Paul Verhoeven freaked everybody out. I don't know. We're all gun shy now.
I mean,
one small crack in your suit. That's you.
But if you had a little water on Mars, I mean, look how dehydrated he is. You just put a little.
That's all he needs.
A little Mars water on there.
A little drop of Mars water. Those eyeballs will go back in his head and he'll be able to swallow his tongue. It'll be good.
And staying in outer space, in 2010, there was the discovery of Gliese 581G.
Cool.
Astronomers announced the discovery of Gliese, I hope I'm saying that correctly, 581G, a potentially habitable exoplanet orbiting the star Gliese 581, located about 20 light years away from Earth, just a hop, skip, and a jump, only 20 nice. Light years. This discovery fueled excitement in the search for habitable planets beyond our solar system. And as you can see in this graphic here, it says the current potential habitable worlds compared to Earth and Mars. And number one most habitable is Gliese 581G.
What up? Hey, now, Earth 2.
I mean, I know it is 20 million light years away, but we'll guess if they're getting pretty excited for, you know, the possibility that we need a plan B, because yeah, you know we're screwing this place up.
Listen, guys, we're pretty screwed here, so we're going full bore on Gliese 581G.
And I guess because it is so similar to Earth, they detected, I guess, from the readings that there is liquid water, which is a, you know, obviously essential to humanity. And if you don't have liquid water, you know what happens? You turn
there
into
you
get
it's all over again.
You get Verhoeven. You get the Verhoeven face.
You know, I wonder though, like what? Okay, so this has, you know, very comparable Earth-like qualities, right? Gliese 581G. Mm-hmm. But what is the one thing that we're not seeing? What's the one weird thing that this planet has that Earth doesn't have? Is there some like really big ass like apex predator that walks around there that we did not figure out? You know, like what's the terror here when we go check this place out?
I'm terrified. If it does have, you know, obviously, like they says, you know, it's got water. We're going to detect water. What hellish like leviathans of the deep are in the water of Gliese 581G?
That's what I'm saying. We don't even know what's deep down in the waters or in on Earth.
Yeah, there's got to be some sort of like outer space monster that's just waiting to have a new Lovecraftian novel written about it. Okay, there we are, Verhoeven face. And then, so this is this is really great. This is a real technical mumbo jumbo for a dummy like me to be talking about. So metamaterials, by synthesizing materials with unconventional and tunable optical properties, physicists and engineers have pioneered new ways to guide and manipulate light, creating lenses that defy the fundamental limits on resolution. They've begun constructing cloaks that can make objects visible. So in this, you can see how they're kind of like magnetic resonance imaging, which MRI. Here it is like a using microwaves to be able to bounce, a frequency back. So you get some full body imaging, using terahertz, which is some sort of electronic field for high resolution opaque imaging, the infrared spectrum for a wider field of view. So again, all of this is far beyond my understanding, but there is, oh, here's some more materials, what they kind of use.
Cool.
Yep, it's just some science. But I think 2010 is a little late to the party when it comes to having cloaks or object visible manipulation, because about, let me see, if it was 2010, so about 30 years or so, actually, there already was something on Earth that had this. I don't know if you can see that because that is cloaked. Maybe when they got this technology, let me see if we can just enhance this a little bit.
That's the cloak
of the Yautja, the Predator alien, which you may know from, of course, Predator fighting Arnold Schwarzenegger. Homeboy already had the cloak.
He already had the cloak.
So what I'm assuming happened was they found pieces of the exploded Predator, maybe from his ship, maybe from himself, even though he let off like an atomic bomb on his wrist. But I mean, Metamaterials in 2010, I think we have the Yautja Predator alien to thank.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. This was way, way before any of that. And yeah, I mean, I think just aliens do it right. We steal a lot of cool shit from aliens.
And let's see, being a little, I guess, not so alien technology, but maybe human technology. So this is what is known as HIV prophylaxis. HIV prevention trials on different novel strategies reported unequivocal success. A vaginal gel that contains the anti-HIV drug tenofovir reduced HIV infections in women by 39%, and an oral pre-exposure prophylaxis led to 43.8% fewer HIV infections in a group of men and transgender women who have had sex with men. So I know you and I both have been in long-term relationship with our respective partners for a while, brother. I don't ever remember hearing about like anti-AIDS vaginal gel. Like,
no, this is definitely a first time hearing of such an innovation. I mean, I know they've come a long way with, you know, AIDS and HIV, you know, preventative medicine. So, I mean, this is, seems like to be at the topical approach to this.
It looks like a mint strip, like one of those dissolving tabs you put on your tongue to freshen your breath. But I think you put that in the hoo-ha.
It dissolves somewhere else. Yeah, yeah.
You put that down on the hoo-ha.
Yeah, it's a very interesting take and a very interesting application. But I mean, yeah, hey man, keeping the AIDS away is a good thing.
So when I was reading this and it said, you know, gel, I imagine like a gel, you know what I mean? Like right. A squeeze tube, like something. This, I guess, I wondered if they had made this application as such. So one, it is in the, like the dose, right? Like the dose of this size gel is like, this is all you need. And because I have a feeling that if you were just to give someone like a tube of anti-AIDS gel, they would be running out of that anti.
Oh, they'd be using
way
it
too much anti-AIDS gel.
Dude. It's like anything topically, just like, oh, just a dab or a dollop. That's never, ever the case. Everybody has a different idea of what that is. And who knows what the freaking side effects of some fucking AIDS gel is, too, you know?
Well, I mean, there's definitely that. But you got to figure, too, it's like if a little bit of AIDS gel will get rid of AIDS, then a lot of AIDS gel will get rid of like all the AIDS. So, I mean, and
just wearing it all over, yep. You're putting it in your hair. And
I mean, I think unless they put it in this type of like deliverable type of dose, I mean, as soon as AIDS gel went on, like, you know, sale or prescription, it would be basically out. We'd be like, we ran through everything, all of it. It's all gone.
Yeah, this woman is just showing us this thing. It's either already been on her vagina or it's going there. So that's also a fun guessing game.
And in conjunction with the HIV prophylaxis, they gel. They're able to minimize it down from the full body condom, which it says here, I bought a few weeks back, but it's a bit snug around the crotch. Good as new, though, 20 pounds collection only.
I love that there's just the little dick sock on the condom, too. That's freaking hilarious.
Dude, if you had this body condom and AIDS gel, there is no AIDS getting through this thing at all.
No, impenetrable. Yeah. It's never happening. You you could just roll into any place, any HIV positive hotspot, untouched wearing that.
Oh, man. Well, there was, there is like some more kind of boring things for science, but I think as far as, you know, the hotness that we needed to get through, I mean, AIDS gel, curing AIDS, which 2010 was 14 years ago. I'm not saying that I need that, but what I'm saying is I would just like to invest in that. I mean, for the Christ Almighty, like how is that not? That's to me, that is the most. We're not on Mars. We're not on Mars. You may say there's water there. I ain't going up there. I don't got no invisibility cloak from an alien. At the very least, you could give the people of Earth here, let them have AIDS-free sex.
Yeah, let them. Please. Let them do whatever they want with their breath mint / aid applicator. I think that's a great.
Now let's hear
idea.
From one of our amazing and valued sponsors who make this whole show possible. Now let's hear from one of our amazing and valued sponsors who make this whole show possible.
Thank you for saying that twice because he was so excited. I guess let's do as AI producer asks us to, and let's roll to a break here, listen to another sponsor, and then we'll be back for our third and final category.
We'll be right back.
Very, very exciting. We'll be right back.
After this motherfucking messages, we'll be right back.
This segment of Acronology Podcast is brought to you by Illegal Boutique. Illegal Boutique, the home of high-end and unethical fashion. Welcome, fashion renegades, to the most illicit destination in town, the Illegal Boutique. At Illegal Boutique, we're breaking all the rules of fashion and commerce. Our clothing is so underground, it's practically subterranean. If your question is, were these jeans made by using child labor? The answer you're looking for is, well, let's just say adult fingers can't sew stitches that small. But that's not all. Our accessories are so unconventional, they redefine the meaning of unfashionable. From endangered species lined winter wear, to plant fibers unlawfully harvested from national parks, to dyes squeezed from protected maritime invertebrates, Illegal Boutique doesn't care about what's lawful. Illegal Boutique only cares about how you look. And the best part? Our prices are so low, they're practically criminal. At Illegal Boutique, anything goes. So if you're ready to break free from the chains of mainstream fashion and dive headfirst into the wild world of the underground, come on down to Illegal Boutique. Illegal Boutique, where fashion goes off the grid.
You are watching an Acronology.
Hello.
Welcome back. Hope you enjoyed that sponsor break. One of our, of course, many amazing sponsors here at Anachronology. And you too can also be an amazing sponsor here at Anachronology. How? Well, we have a Patreon page. You can go to patreon.com/Anachronology. Check out our sponsors. Become a sponsor. We do a lot of cool stuff for sponsors. Every episode, we make two extra pieces of content. Everybody gets a special segment and a whole extra category for the year that we've traveled back to. So, I mean, that's pretty generous, I got to say. I got to pat us on the back. Say we're pretty nice to do that. We love doing it anyway. That, along with a bunch of other special fun stuff up on our Discord channel. And if you don't want to do the Patreon subscribe thing, well, you could help us out and do the subscribey thing on YouTube or the follow thing on TikTok and Instagram. And just help us grow and show people our stuff. Tell them how cool we are.
I don't want to toot our own horn, but we have had some people like our stuff and give it a couple subscribes and follows. So if you would like what you're seeing as much as we like doing it, why don't you just do it for free? Get a little subscriber, a little follow on one of those platforms. And if you're feeling extra generous, like Tom said, our Patreon has some extra bonus content for you, depending on what year it is, you get a little more of what we got. Amen. So our final and last category is cartoons.
So first, we have never had a cartoons category. This is exciting. I mean, nothing is just going, oh my god, 2010, this cartoon. I'm obviously a child of the 80s and 90s, so are you, and I think we kind of set the bar rather high for what we think are good cartoons. But you know, I've been surprised over the years. I do think there are some cartoons that still continue to come out that are very fun and garner a whole new audience.
I actually really like this category. Unfortunately, 2010 for my cartoon watching, I am unfamiliar. I shouldn't say unfamiliar. I am familiar with what AI producer spat out, but I did not. I know that they have a big following. I can just tell by the names that their client or their fan base is rabid for these cartoons. And as someone who I will take almost like a cartoon, whether it's a television show or an animated film, I feel, over live action for, I don't want to say like better than, but anytime someone says, I don't like cartoons. Cartoons are dumb. I'm not saying you haven't like seen the right cartoon. I just don't agree with that person's taste in media because there are so many well-done animated projects. And in 2010, kicking off 2010, they had Adventure Time. Now, Adventure Time, animated television series created by Pendleton Ward, which that's a great name. Pendleton Ward. That's a good name.
It's very proper.
Yeah, right. Pendleton Ward became wildly popular for its unique style, humor, imaginative storytelling. It follows the adventures of a boy named Finn and his magical dog companion, Jake, in the post-apocalyptic land of Ooh. While Adventure Time features whimsical and lighthearted elements, it also explores deeper themes such as friendship, morality, and existentialism. See, I told you cartoons can be doing some pretty good stuff. The show's narrative is rich with mythology and lore, gradually revealing the history and secrets of the land of Oo. Throughout its run, Adventure Time gathered a dedicated fan base and critical acclaim for its creativity, character development, and ability to blend humor with moments of emotional depth. It concluded its original series run in 2018, so it got 8 freaking years. I mean, that's a good run for any TV show. 8 years. Continues to be celebrated for its impact on animation and storytelling.
Yeah, absolutely. I was saying the iconic characters of the two main characters here. You see it all over the place. I especially like cosplay or at any of the cons, these characters kind of ring true, and it's cool. And it has created this little culture, this little fandom. And I think I've seen one or two of them, and they're different, you know, but they're fun, and you can tell they are rich with like their story and the lore of the show.
I know that the meme game, like the meme grabbed from Adventure Time, I'll definitely see a lot of, there's this, he's like the Ice King or something. I've seen that guy a lot. Jake, the dog, I've seen a lot. But we can do a little, I think we have a little, there's our YouTube page. It costs you nothing to subscribe to that. Let's go to, here we go. We'll do a little Adventure Time opening just to give a little, there's a 25 seconds. We don't have to watch the full episode or anything, but let's do a little Adventure Time opening.
Adventure Time, come on, grab your friends. We'll go to very distant lands. We'll take the dog and then the human. The one will never end. It's Adventure Time.
Brilliant.
So
simple, right to the point. I love that. That's a sign of a good cartoon.
And whoopsie, go back. Yeah. And for you know, for that kind of like lighthearted little like little ditty of an intro, I like the fact that it says it deals with like existentialism. I'm not getting like dealing with mortality from that, but apparently the show packs a punch.
They hit it,
pulls on the heartstrings. All right, so now here's one, as I just said not but minutes ago, I love cartoons. Here's one that I don't think, as much as I love cartoons, I will ever dedicate time to being a fan of. That is My Little Pony, Friendship is Magic, apparently debuting in 2010. Hey, this is another good name, though. Lauren Faust. She literally made a deal with the devil. How Faustian. To get her My Little Pony show made. It is based on the My Little Pony franchise created by Hasbro. No shit. Premiered in 2010, quickly gained a large and diverse fan base, including children, teenagers, and adults of all genders. I guess they needed to specify that. The series follows the adventures of Twilight Sparkle, a studious unicorn pony, and her friends known as the Main Six. Oh, I see what they did. The main set. It's M-A-N-E, like horses.
Oh,
main,
that horse.
I see what they've done there. What they've done there. The show is set in the magical land of Equestria, where various creatures such as ponies, dragons, other mystical da-da-da-da-da-da, celebrated for positive messages, vibrant animation, well-developed characters, and engaging storytelling. It has become known for its community of fans who are often referred to as bronies, male fans, and pegasisters for the female fans.
There's a lot going on in that fandom. I mean, bronies definitely started to make its way into the zeitgeist soon thereafter this show aired. And I do think it almost kind of took over the show itself, because everything associated was with this brony culture. And it was like middle-aged to like 40-plus-year-old men all showing up to these cons, like dressed either as a My Little Pony or rocking that My Little Pony pride.
So I did not have any AI producer pulled up bronies or mega sisters, because I feel like those people have suffered enough. But I also feel like this is different from like being a furry, correct? Being a brony Like, I think you can be both. I think you can be
potent mix.
I think you can be both. But yeah, for the non-furry aspect of it, like how it says the adults of all genders being bronies and Pegasisters.
I don't want to
be at the water cooler or, you know, you're at the football game or something. It's like, oh, what'd you do this weekend or whatever. It's like, I dressed up like a My Little Pony with a bunch of other adults. And I don't know what you do when you dress up as My Little Pony, but it doesn't like I don't want to discourage anyone from having fun, but I want to discourage grown men and grown women from dressing up like these little My Little Pony characters, because I don't think that's a good I'm no psychiatrist, but I don't think that's a good, I guess, place for your brain to be living
it's,
in this
it's
crazy
quite
world.
A common link between two people. I wonder if a Pegasister and a Brony have ever married, can you imagine that wedding, that invite of just going and being like the straight people that didn't understand what they were walking into?
I would love to be a fly on the wall in that wedding, but
man, me too.
I tell you what, if whoever the bronies and Pegasisters, if they didn't end up marrying each other, I know what they did do. They ended up living in their parents' house until their parents died, and then they got like put in a group home. Because dude, this got like autism written all over it, man.
Not a lot. It's pretty dense.
I mean, just being like 30 years old, like freaking out because they're all Little Pony episodes.
This is not your 80s My Little Pony either. So this has come a long way from that, whatever the hell that even was back in the 80s.
You know, there's probably some like Fortune 500 guy sitting in a boardroom, like a meeting or maybe a Zoom call. And then his cell phone ringtone goes off and it's My Little Pony. I'm sorry, what was that? My Little Pony, just fumbling for his phone, trying to get his phone. Like that's like they
take out.
Yeah, right. They take it that far. I am so much of a Brony or a Pegasister. I need the ringtone. And the last big, I say, cartoon that debuted is a regular show. Now, also similar to Adventure Time. The surreal adventures of two best friends, a blue jay named Mordecai and a raccoon named Rigby, who works as groundskeepers at a park. Despite being adults, Mordecai and Rigby often find themselves in bizarre and fantastical situations, encountering supernatural creatures, time-traveling anomalies, and eccentric characters. The humor of regular show stems from its absurd and surreal scenarios, as well as the banter between Mordecai and Rigby. It incorporates elements of 1980s and 90s pulp culture. We should be watching that.
Absolutely.
Music appearing to both children and adults. Like, regular show garnered critical acclaim for its unique animation style, offbeat humor, character-driven storytelling, concluded after eight seasons. So another eight-season run. Along with Adventure Time 2010 to 2008. This is another one, much like Adventure Time, I've caught so little of.
Yeah.
But I guess us being born when we were born, if you were like a 2000, if you're born in like what, late 90, 2000, if this came out in 2010, this is probably right up your alley in your house. So I'm a little sad that I kind of missed the boat on this, like having enough, after school time or whatever to watch some regular show and some Adventure Time. But what we do have here is what I did like was this. So regular show. Pause this before we pull this up. So, you know, much like any, whether it is a live action television show, whether it is a movie, a cartoon, especially the theme song, how does it open, right? Like, what does it get you with? So I did as much digging as a AI producer would let me. And I thought this was super interesting for the intro of this cartoon regular show. So let me just pull at this. Let's go look at our YouTube page and then take this off and just it. Let me see regular show intro. That's all you get is that.
That's it.
Love it.
That's been it through all time.
So as far as I could tell, like, again, I didn't end up like AI producer didn't like kick out a full episode for me to like sit down and watch here. But I went through there was so many more remixes of the show. Like there, I found everything that wasn't everything that was longer than 5 seconds was all fan made. It was all like I said, remix. So that's why I'm like, oh man, this is awesome. If that's like for 5 seconds, that's all you get. Like
super quick and one and done. I love it.
And the reason why I like that so much is because what started playing right after that 5 seconds, because I couldn't pause it quick enough. So this is the regular show Hindi intro. Awesome. So this is much like somewhere in Bollywood. They cannot have anything like that. Show is 5 seconds. The intro with just one little like kind of like electronic tone, kind of little waveform. This is the Bollywood intro, not even Bollywood, but this is the Hindi intro to regular show.
Yeah.
Say what?
A thoda fast, thoda slow, jo hona hai hone do. A little high, a little low, yeah, regular show.
बाबूजी कहते थे ए छोटे बड़े छोटे बड़े ए ए छोटे बड़े छोटे बड़े
छोटे बड़े हैं इनका नाम
तो नहीं है इनको
बस का ना आ रहा करते हैं बस का काम कमा
ए छोटे बड़े छोटे बड़े ए ए छोटे बड़े छोटे बड़े छोटे बड़े छोटे बड़े ए ए छोटे बड़े
बाबूजी कहते थे चलने लेने को
एंड दैट्स व्हाट यू गेट फॉर रेगुलर शो इंट्रो इन हिंदी.
Dude, it's great. And, you know, again, it is one of those shows that I feel I've definitely missed the boat on it. Because, again, like you're saying, there's a huge culture that surrounds it, both in like just like fan made art and like remixes of the show. Like that show's a show, no matter what, that just even if it was on for 8 seasons, it has a rabid fan base. And that's cool. I mean, they got to be doing something right to captivate people for that long.
And those were the cartoon programs. There was also a big year for animated films in 2010. So we'll just kind of go through these. Some of the, I would say the, I haven't seen them all, so I can't say like the better, like the cream of the crop. But I think people will be, if you didn't see these, you'd be like, oh man, I should probably go back and watch those. So from 2010, we have Scooby-Doo, Abracadabra-Doo. Everyone is, I'm sure, familiar with Scooby-Doo. So it's 2010. We had Scooby-Doo, Abracadabra-Doo. We also had Birds of Paradise, Meet the Flockers, which I think was a
wow.
I think this is a sequel to the, what was that game that on the phone, Angry Birds. I think this is like an Angry Birds. I don't know.
This is that sweet spot when like every other tiny animation studio or any offshoot animation studio was like open the floodgates because Pixar was doing well. DreamWorks was, I mean, look at this. This is definitely what this era is. 2010. Everybody was like, we could make animated movies and animated trilogies. It's just like, oh my God, dude. And
speaking of the floodgates, my friend, you weren't wrong because we've got Winx Club Magical Adventure, whatever the hell that is. Whatever Winx Magical
Adventure. There's a lot going on in there. Unicorns, fairies.
There's like in the upper left hand corner evil there, women. There's some like evil, like Emperor's New Groove Yesma lady, but instead of being
Nickelodeon too, yeah, throwing its name on there. Wow.
It's the Winx Club Magical Adventure. And what else is there? There is Space Dogs.
that's easy.
Their helmets say CCCP, which is Russian. So I don't know if this is like a Russian film.
Space Bugs.
Oh yeah, right. Or if this is
Space Cosmonauts,
some sort of like Western or European produced movie that then they made about the Space Dogonauts. After Space Riding. Dogs, we've got Fire Breather.
Oh my God, that looks great.
And all of these, might I add, all of these are over an hour long. These are all feature length cartoon movies. So someone was not only just making like a 20 minute, 30 minute, like one off.
They were making some serious.
They were pushing out for like popcorn movie theater in seats one time. After Fire Breather, we have Crazy Cat.
Oh, with a K. You know it's crazy.
So when the little bit of info so that I got from Crazy Cat was apparently Crazy Cat was a Sunday, or not even like a newspaper cartoon from like 1950. fucking 30 or 50s or something. So someone who's like the estate of Crazy Cat must have been like, we're gonna lose the pat or the, you know, the publishing rights on this. What can we do to retain them? I don't know. I guess make a really crappy full length movie, being Crazy Cat and the Santa Apprentice.
I like this. I like where they're going with this. Santa Apprentice. It's a lot. It's a mouthful, but what it tells a story already.
The Santa Apprentice. And then what's after Santa Apprentice? The worst animated movie of 2010, Despicable Me. I lumped Despicable Me in here with all these other crappy ones because I would watch every one of those movies back to back to back for the history of my life. Or it could be the only, if I could have all of those on a desert island or this one, I would take all of those.
Yeah, the whole Minion craze, it's just like, you know, it obviously caught on and they've made 100 different Minion things. And the whole, like, the stupid language of the Minions and the costumes and the toys and the merchandise. I mean, it was a huge cash grab, but you're right. It's like, maybe if you have kids and you just put it on to entertain them and you can step away for a while, great, you know, Minion it up, but I have no purpose for the Minions. I think they're just fucking annoying.
So you know how I'm sure you probably run into this, right? Like if you you talk to your parents, right, and they say, you know, a movie I saw that was pretty good, and it could be some crappy movie, or you could actually be like, oh, wow, actually guys like that, it's pretty good
all the time.
Like my dad is notorious for, like, he'll watch, like, I don't even want to say crap. Like, he doesn't watch a lot of movies. Like, he just doesn't have, I think he's just over watching movies. You know what I mean? Like, he just wants to, you
all
know,
all the good ones have already been made.
Yeah. Right. He wants to, like, just, I guess, get upset at, like, the news. You know what I mean? Watch the Giants and Yankees play and then, like, go to bed. He doesn't really watch movies. Dude, I can't remember, like, in the relative recent amount of time, like, I would say, like, 2-3 years, something like that. You know, he's got HBO or cable, whatever, and he just flips through the channels. And he's like, oh, you know what? You know what movie I saw was pretty good? I saw, what movie was that, Dad? He goes, well, what are those little yellow things? I'm like,
oh, my God.
And he's like, oh, yeah, there's the guy's got a big nose. And I was like, Despicable Me. He's like, that's what it was. I wanted to reach through the phone and strangle the life out of my father.
Please, Dad,
for telling me that Despicable Me was a good freaking movie.
I really enjoyed it.
I can't freaking believe that. Well, speaking of, that's the end of the animated film, the cartoons that I want to give any credence to here in 2010. But that leads us to our final segment, which is a little bit of a guilty pledge.
Hey,
so this is a little bit of they're not cartoons, but they're definitely some watchables. So the first guilty pledge that I brought up, and I don't necessarily know, like, I don't feel bad about saying I like this program, but as far as, you know, something that's on on TV that I remember, like, binging it when it I remember, like, even waiting or being excited for when the final season aired. Justified on FX. Are unfamiliar with Justified, created by Graham Yost, based on the works of crime novelist Elmore Leonard. Show aired from 2010. 2015, well received by critics and audience alike. Set in Kentucky, Justified follows the story of Deputy U.S. Marshal Raylan Givens, played by Timothy Olyphant. Raylan is a tough and old-fashioned lawman with a strong sense of justice, but he finds himself at odds with his superiors due to his unorthodox methods. So it is a modern-day Western, kind of. I mean, as you can see here, the main character, he's a lawman with a gun and a hat, very much the white hat, also like the good guy in the white hat trope. And for being on TV, for being a network drama, even though the network was FX, and it had the benefit of being boosted by Elmore Leonard's source material, it is... Like, I call it a guilty pledge because I'm not the biggest fan of, like, procedural. What kind of flavor of the week bad guy are we going to have here? But Justified, to me, does an excellent job of having the each season kind of has, like, an arc or a story to it. There are reoccurring characters. There are characters that get killed off. But it is, to me, I consider it a guilty pledge because, like I said, I am not the biggest fan of all you know, any just kind of bang, bang, shoot them up, good guy, bad guy. But Justified is definitely on my list of guilty pleasure.
Well put. You know? Justified is great, man. And he kills it in the role. And there's so many good supporting characters. I mean, right off the top of my head, Walton Goggins is incredible in it. He kind of just plays that the yin and yang character who's kind of the anti-hero at some points, but he's also kind of the thorn in Raylan's side. And great performances. And you're right, it's just at first glance it takes that tonality of like, oh, this is that procedural, it's the same thing every time, and he always comes out, you know, the hero. And I think like there's lots of defeat for this character, and God, I don't know how many seasons it went on, but I even know they came back and did a whole other series with Raylan, the character. I mean, it's got a pretty big fan base.
Yeah. The City Primeval, the one that was just on like this past year, I don't think it is as good as the OG series. This, if we pull this little up, there's a little teaser, a little taste, a little 30-second, a little flavor. This is actually from like season four, this says little teaser clip. Let me just pull this here in the front forefront here. So here's like a little flavor if you guys want to get a little flavor of what kind of like tongue-in-cheekedness the humor is.
Very familiar. In fact, I know what you're thinking. Did he fire 17 shots or 16? I think I may have lost track myself. So I suppose there's only one question you should be asking yourself.
Do I feel lucky?
I wasn't watching the other end.
So there's a nice little tongue in cheek, a nice little kind of what shows. Yeah, it's not always you know, it is quippy and it is like, you know, guns are firing, but it's also the writing is a little better than that, better than just shooting guns. This one is definitely a fun guilty pleasure. Blue Mountain State.
Forgot about this one. Yeah.
Dude, I can't remember how this like came across, you know, my plate. I cannot freaking remember. This we see here what AI producer gave us here. Blue Mountain State offers a humorous and often exaggerated portrayal of the college football culture, featuring wild parties, locker room antics, and the pressures of balancing academics with athletics. The show explores themes of friendship, competition, and the pursuit of success both on and off the field. I think that's a little like they're actually like painting this out to be very like highbrow actually by that.
Yeah, I feel like that was the kind stroke of what this show is. I mean, this show is basically like every I don't know, 80s, early 90s the football comedy movie that came out. It's got raunchiness, it's got partying. But the interesting part about this show is I think it was the writing was a little bit better than one would think. You know, you go into a show like this and be like, oh, you know, it's just going to be all the same setups and same gags. But the characters are really funny and they had some pretty funny storylines.
And this guy right here, the Thad character played by, what's his name? Aiden Richardson. What's his name? Richardson, the guy who's Reacher right now, Jack Reacher.
Yeah, he's that a fucking beast now, that guy.
Dude, Jeez. And he is probably the funniest character on that show. And case funny. In point, we're gonna go to a little clip that is called Blue Mountain State Pocket Pussy.
Fucking big weed, piece of plastic. This thing came from Bosnia, son. You ever been to Bosnia? You ever been in the shit? Well, my dad was, and he left me this pocket pussy. And every time I sink my humongous dick in this piece of plastic, I remember my dad. So watch your mouth, Rosh.
Rosh.
Wow. Oh, man, the fact that there is he is saying that his father gave him a pocket pussy that he got in Bosnia when he was fighting like the Herzegovina War is
amazing.
Like that is, I would dare I say that is like you said, the writing is, you know, better on this like, you know, as far as comedies go, standard comedy. I don't know any other comedy that are they bringing a pocket pussy that are their deceased dad got a character from Bosnia.
Yeah, it just went there. I don't know who the original like who what it aired on. Do you know that?
It was some kind of
not a no-name network, but a small network, not like Spike or something like that.
I'm trying to remember, man. It's killing me. I'm trying to remember. I knew I watched it on like Amazon. That's however I streamed it. I cannot remember. That is a good question.
That's true, because when I had first watched it too, I want to say I watched it after it had aired originally. Oh, okay. AI producer just threw it out. An American sitcom. It premiered on Spike TV.
Spike TV. Okay.
Spike tried for a while to have content, and this was probably their biggest thing out the gate. But it, you know, I mean, hey, I mean, even look at Denise Richards is in it too. They're like, hey, you know, you can come on and kind of act. I don't know, old hot, whatever she was trying to do there.
Yeah, but I don't even think Spike has like TV shows anymore. I don't think, you know what I mean? Like, no, I think
that network that always struggled with their identity. Like, are we a game show network? Are we trying to make content? Are we rerun Central? You know, it's like that's what all those things start off as.
And the last guilty pleasure I have, and this one's definitely. This one's right up my alley. I'll give everyone a little glimpse behind the curtain of, aside from a Justified on Blue Mountain State, of what I like. So this movie on the left, this came out in 2010. I have not seen this one, the remake, because it is a remake of this 2005 film called 13 Zmedi. And the plot of 13 Zmedi revolves around Sebastian, a young man who becomes embroiled in a dangerous underground game of Russian roulette after stumbling upon a mysterious envelope intended for someone else. The envelope contains instructions leading him to participate in a deadly game where participants gamble with their lives. So I don't want to give too much away for that, but here is the trailer. We should just give people a little flavor of en français. So this guy doesn't know doesn't know what's this envelope that he found is
all black and white.
It's all black and white, super low budget.
I like that.
So you got to play the game. He's like, okay. And again, this one is from 05, so the remake in 2010, which is like the Hollywood supervisor, hand out one bullet to each player.
Whoa. It's heavy.
Mm-hmm. Right? So it's a little like, okay, what's going on?
Getting all the stars.
Attention.
Get ready.
Attention.
Round one's about to start. Step back, he says. Because he's number 13. There we go. It's Smedy. So loaded. So they're all putting bullets into a gun. One bullet into a cylinder of a revolver.
Damn.
Raise your gun.
Spin
the cylinder.
Yeah. Spin that shit. Good. Oh, man. You point it at another person?
Oh, yeah. And then... When the bulb lights up, you shoot.
Wow.
Oh, yeah.
Wow. Is this just a teaser? Good Lord.
It's just the tension, right? They're all just looking up at the light bulb with guns pointed at each other.
Yeah.
So that's what you get for
And now you know you see that and then you just go, how good could even the American, I mean the American yeah. version is probably very watered down, and I mean obviously I see 50 Cent on the cast list. I don't know about that.
Yeah, although I cannot speak to the 13 movie in 2010, I do recommend the movie that is based off of the 2005 Zmedi 13. That was our guilty pleasure.
That's a good rec. I haven't even seen that one, so I'll probably check that out. Thanks, man. That's great. That was a fun little segment we like to do, guilty pleasure. Let's go to our final sponsor break, and then let's come back to round off the year that has been 2010. We did it, everybody. We made it all the way through. We'll see you in a sec.
We'll see you after these very short messages, so get your asses back to the chopper.
Alrighty, this commercial break on Anachronology is brought to you by Brat Scrappers. Are your kids running wild with no regard for the rules? Is your home starting to feel like a toy battleground? Introducing Brat Scrappers, the tough love solution for unruly kids and frustrated parents. When you've had it up to here with the tantrums, the disobedience, the toy tornadoes, fear not. Brat Scrappers are here to bring peace back to your home. Our team will confiscate those troublesome toys right before your child's eyes. Choose your level of tough love, from incineration to explosion, or even making your own child destroy their prized possessions themselves. Brat Scrappers will even accommodate a trip down to the town dumpster incinerator, so the former apples of your eye can watch what they once held so dear be turned to ash and scattered to the wind. Tough love has never felt so good, because tough love is better than no love. So why wait? Say goodbye to chaos and hello to peace with Brat Scrappers.
You are watching an Acronology.
Hey, you are watching Anachronology. Welcome back, everybody, and thanks again for joining us today on this episode as we traveled to 2010. Found out a lot, stuff we didn't know before we came into this. Some fairly interesting topics, ones that I don't think right off the bat we were comfortable with. Learned a little something, because that's what we do here. We're about having some laughs, learning some things, remembering some things. You know, it's fun.
I gotta say, with a category like science, there is so much a layman like Tom and myself can present to y'all, but I hope you guys, like Tom said, you learned something, you had a laugh. A little bit of cartoons, a topic that we never had on here before, and both two shows, at least, not My Little Pony, but at least Adventure Time and Regular Show. I feel like those are two things that I should probably add to my knowledge of cartoons that I have watched, and a little something called sports, which, although it is, you know, like also said, not the most athletic guy in the world, but, you know, the sports is something that all cultures all around the world, they have their games, they have their, you know, the things that draw them together as a nation. And we saw that with the World Cup. We saw that with the 2010 Olympics, and we saw that with Curt Schilling's video game going belly up because he stole a bunch of money from people. So
yeah, and rolling cheese, which incredible sports pastime in other countries, which
it is time for an entertaining segment.
Okay. Hey, AI producer, I guess that we have time for one more segment. Look at that, you lucky dogs. Okay, so I see what we got coming in the line here. So something we've done on the show before, Epoch Traverser is a pretty incredible supercomputer. Not only can it help us temporally travel to anywhere in history and time and space, it also has a way of kind of doing a little weird peskiness by contacting us on other timelines and other dimensions and other, I guess you could say, in other instances throughout the time-space continuum. I think on one of the past shows, we actually spoke to 70s me. I really didn't agree with some of his rhetoric, but he was an interesting dude. And it appears we have a message that just came in. It's for you, Clay. So it looks like it's coming to us all the way from the 1920s. Let's give it a go.
Okay.
You there, from the future, listen to me. Living in 1920 isn't what it used to be. Not at all. First off, this whole hullabaloo about women voting. It's preposterous. Women meddling in politics? Ridiculous. Our society's going downhill faster than a runaway train. Ooh. And don't even get me started on this wretched prohibition business. Outlawing alcohol, can you believe it? A man out to have the freedom to enjoy a good drink after a hard day's work, not be treated like some sort of criminal. What's more, these immigrants flooding into our country, bringing their strange customs and foreign languages. It's unsettling, I tell you. America should be for Americans, not for every Tom, Dick, and Harry who washes up on our shores. And the stench. Good Lord, the smell of people crammed into tenements like sardines in a can. Wow. It's unbearable. This country used to stand for something, but now it's turning into a melting pot of chaos and confusion. Mark my words, young man, if things keep heading in this direction, we'll soon find ourselves adrift in a sea of chaos with no compass to guide us back to sanity.
Okay. Oh my God. Wow. I mean, spoken very truly, I guess, coming from the 1920s, but alternate you. Wow.
Well, if
only the pick, huh?
I'm assuming that 1920s me lost it all in the 1929 stock market crash, because I had a nice little office there. I think I had some cufflinks on. I had like
very dapper as well. I got to say, you pulled it off.
Dapper Dan man haircut, but my God, I guess a little jingoistic there, not liking anybody who's not all the way American. True blue. Jeez,
throwing some MAGA vibes back in the 20s, but it's all good. Well, interesting. That was a fun little time wines, as we like to call them here, a segment here on the show. But yeah, I mean, again, really appreciate everybody watching the show, supporting it in any way that you can. If it's just liking something, subscribing to something, every little thing counts, and it's been great. We've been doing, like I said, it's our eighth one that we've done, having a lot of fun. We try to change up the format, keep it fresh and different all the time. And again, open to suggestions. Where should we go? What should we talk about? What did we miss? What can we do better? All that is very welcome.
And like we said before, if you just take your time to subscribe for free, and if you want to throw us a couple extra shekels, then the Patreon is right there for you, where we give extra for each episode. We give you an extra segment and an extra extra little special feature for whatever year we happen to be in.
Because that's what we do here on Anachronology. And thanks for tuning in. We'll catch you next week. Another year, another episode, more craziness awaits. Thanks,
everybody. Anachronology, where it's about damn time. We'll see ya.
Later. Bye.